If you have ever visited or worked in an industrial facility, you most probably have seen a lot of electrical and control panels in there. This is a sample layout of an industrial plant, and the panels are located in one or multiple rooms. But if we explore every nook and cranny of the plant, chances are we discover some other electrical cabinets installed outside of these particular rooms. Today, we're going to find out more about these types of panels and the reasons for locating them around the plant. Previously, we have talked about PLC control panels. As you might recall, we put some input and output cards on the same rack as the PLC. We have called them direct input and outputs, or simply direct IOs. You can also call them local rack-based IOs. Obviously, these input and output cards are meant to be connected to the field devices like instruments, valves, and so on. Until 40 or 50 years ago, connecting these IO cards to the end devices at the field was through parallel cabling and using marshaling units and some junction boxes in between. For instance, we had to first connect the wires of an individual cable coming from a sensor to a box full of terminal box, or say, a junction box. Then, we connect specific conductors of a multi-conductor cable to the other side of this terminal box inside of the junction box. The other side of this multi-conductor cable has been connected to the marshaling terminals within the PLC panel. And finally, the marshaling terminals were getting connected to the direct IOs on the PLC rack. This method, however, is still applicable today, but has some limitations and disadvantages. For example, if the distance from the main PLC becomes more than a certain limit, there are restrictions for implementation, like the risk of voltage drop over the lengthy cables. Today, with the advancement of industrial communication protocols like Profibus, Fieldbus Foundation, IO-Link, AS interface, and so on, and of course, with the emergence of technologies like fiber optic in data transferring cables, there is a far better method for doing so. Yes, we can use remote input and output systems. In fact, in addition to using the direct or local rack-based IOs, we also bring some IO cards to the remote and difficult-to-reach areas across the factory that are far away from the main PLC control panel, and we have lots of sensors, actuators, transmitters, and so on installed on the machines and the process equipment in there. After hardwiring these devices to the remote I/O cards by connecting a two-wire field bus communication cable between the PLC and an interface module on the remote I/O rack, we will be able to send and receive signals to and from PLC. Depending on the distance between the PLC panel and the remote I/O panel, we have to choose a field bus copper cable or a fiber optic cable with some converters in between. So we have very fewer limitations on the distance, and we can bring the data from kilometers away from the main control panel, thanks to the fiber optic technology. You might have noticed, as opposed to the previous method, we have used much less cable and spend much less time on the cable trays, conduits, and cabling works, and the result is spending much less money. Furthermore, it almost halves the number of termination points, which also helps save lots of time on wire terminating works. It is also a major decrease in points of failure, especially in cases where the junction boxes are attached to a vibrating device. As a result, it makes our lives way easier in terms of troubleshooting. This method also eases the expanding phase of the project in the future. Although extremely cost-effective and time-saving, this method sometimes might have a major disadvantage. For instance, in this sample network, if we lose the connection between any remote I/O cabinets and the PLC panel Then all of the signals from or to that specific remote I/O cabinet will be lost. The result? Downtime in the process and wasting a lot of money. There is a solution to this problem, however. For example, here we can manipulate the topology of our network and use a ring topology. Therefore, if we lose the data from one route, there would be still a redundant route for communicating the data. To even further increase the reliability of our network, we can also consider redundancy in other levels like network cables, interface modules, PLC, etc. So, you might be wondering if the local or direct IOs can still be useful. Well, direct IOs are supposed to communicate with the inputs and outputs that are close enough to the PLC panel, say 20 or 50 meters away. We can directly connect these sensors and actuators to the local IOs inside the PLC panel. If the number of the local IO cards exceeds the PLC rack's capacity, we could add them to another rack below the PLC rack, using the interface or expansion cards and network cables. Bear in mind that this is an introductory video about remote IOs, and there are lots of other considerations while you are designing your network. For instance, for better performance and higher reliability of your process, you should not put a critical signal, like an encoder, on a remote I/O network, as it does not have the fastest scan rate for a deterministic operation. What should we do then? Watch the next videos to find out. Alright, are you ready for a quick review? Looking for the sensor and actuator accumulation throughout the field and their distance from the main control panel is an essential consideration. This will help you decide the location of each remote I/O panel in case you want to use them. Don't forget to consider some spare input and output channels or cards either for remote I/O panels and local I/O racks. This will help the operation people to add extra devices to the automation system in the future. Remember to benefit from the redundancy and flexibility features of the field bus networks in your industrial facility to make your network more reliable and available. By using remote IOs, the amount of cable and the labor we need for cable trays, conduits, and cabling works will be extremely less than conventional methods, and regardless of the size of our expansion, we have to bring only a single field bus cable to our PLC panel. Ultimately, considering all factors, the overall cost is much less in comparison with traditional methods. As always, I hope you liked this video. Thanks for watching!